It's really wonderful to be here as part of the Shababa Network Summit, and to I again publicly want to thank Karina and Marissa and all of the Bronfman Center staff for all the work they have done. And therefore, because they did the work, I take no responsibility for the topic of this afternoon's conversation. And I think that as we go on, you'll see how the topic evolves, and hopefully we will give you the opportunity at the end, not hopefully, we will give you opportunity at the end to ask your own questions of us. And casting aside the typical etiquette of introductions, I'm going to do away with long biographies of each of you because that would take up most of our time. And simply to say that I'm going to mention by name each of you and your institutional connection, if there is one. And then I would hope that during the course of the conversation, there will be opportunities for you to tell the story more pertinently about who you are and what you're doing and your connection to Jewish life. So firstly, we have Reverend Eleanor Harrison Bregman, who's director of the Multi-Faith Initiatives at Romumu in New York City. Everybody just have to say Romumu. We know exactly what it is, and perhaps during the conversation you'll say a little bit more about that institution. Erwin Kula, who's president of KLAL. Rabbi Brent Chaim Spodek, who is from Beacon Hebrew Alliance in Beacon, New York. And to my immediate right, Sharon Thomas, who is director of the Maya Educational Resource Center and a Shababa Mama, which probably in this group gives her higher status. And there are probably some other mamas out there. So let's begin. The title of the conversation has been announced as Jewish Identity, the Truth, Fears, Hopes, and Illusions, which I think allows us total openness on anything we want to talk about. There are some among us who are in some level of conversation ask the question is, what does Jewish identity mean? Is there such a thing as Jewish identity? Does it exist? Is it important? So let's dive in. If at all, what does it mean to you and how has it evolved in your lives? And I'll just let any one of you who wants to jump in and grapple with that, I think, essential question to do so. Sharon?
All right, I guess I'll start.
You were shaking your head. That's a nod.
So thank you. Thank you for the invitation to be here. I find myself in a unique and very privileged position. I also thank Karina Zilberman for inviting me so warmly into the Shababa community. The Shababa community for me has been like a lifeline to sustaining a calm in stormy seas and parenting. I was brought to Shababa mornings at the Y by my best friend, Ilana Grossman Rosenbluth, and she and I met in our building. We're both from São Paulo, Brazil, where I was born and raised for 12 years. And it turns out we had a lot in common, except the religious aspect. And she said to me one day, you know, this is a wonderful community, come join us on Saturdays, and what better thing at 10 a.m. for a parent of a newborn to join another community of parents who have children and babies and are up since 5 a.m. And that's really how my exposure started to Judaism in a much deeper form. My husband is Jewish, but he didn't really bring so much of the religious aspect.
An American Jew?
An American Jew from Philadelphia. I did what my mother wanted me to do.
Does your mother take credit for it?
Absolutely.
Okay.
So for me, this piece about Jewish identity is a continuous search, as is parenting. Coming from Brazil with parents who, one was British, one was Brazilian, who were already very different in many of their beliefs. I was used to stepping into differences and sort of finding a comfort and a niche in it. I'm always very curious to hear about why people do what they do, what customs have evolved as civilizations have evolved. And I think a lot of what I see in Judaism makes so much sense to me. One of the pieces that I greatly cherish is Shabbat. I think it's brilliant, the idea of bringing people together at the end of a week, you know, to talk, to eat, to communicate. I mean, to me, that's mental health. You know, that's community. That is feeling like you're part of a fabric that's larger than yourself. I'm still in that search very much. You know, I feel like I'm learning through my 8-year-old daughter who corrects me all the time. And how I pronounce words in Hebrew and how I view certain traditions. She's in Hebrew school now, and so she's teaching me a lot.
So by implication, you introduced the topic of multiple identities, of which Jewish is one for you, Brazilian another, and so on. Someone like to, Brent, did you raise your hand, or?
Sure.
You just look intelligent, so.
It's good acting. I actually feel like I want to push back on the question a little bit. I feel like the notion of identity, which we Jews are a little bit obsessed with, I think is somewhat of a red herring. You know, it occurred to me at some point that I've sat in a lot of different Buddhist meditation halls, and never once has anybody ever asked me, so are you Buddhist? Is your mother Buddhist? What does it mean for you to be Buddhist? The question was, you want to sit? Sit. You don't want to sit? Go. And I think that as a community rabbi, I all the time get people coming in tied up in knots. I'm Jewish, but my partner's not Jewish. I am this, and you know, I'm not this, I'm good this, I'm not that. And I think that, you know, to borrow a line from my teacher Irwin, you know, the question of what is Judaism doing for you? What is the problem Judaism is solving in your life? Is one that we don't answer because we're so obsessed with the identity question. And in some ways, I would challenge anybody who's tied up with the question of Jewish identity to describe what Judaism is without using the word Judaism.
Right, great.
So, you know, to say, okay, I'm fired up about Shabbat, I'm fired up about the idea of a day of rest, or I'm fired up about kashrut and bringing holiness to how I eat, or any of the things that Judaism does, great. But the identity question, in no other arena of my life does it make sense. Like, I'm not a hiker. I don't define myself as a hiker and then debate whether or not I go hiking. I hike. If there's a group of hikers, we could talk about hiking. But there's no identity to being a hiker other than the activity. And I think that when we talk about Jewish identity, we focus so much on this label, we entirely neglect to focus on what the content of Judaism is and how it can enrich our lives. And I think that's part of what Shabbat does really well, is bring Shabbat to life in ways that are meaningful to people, whether you're Jewish or not.
I'm like,
so Irwin, I see
I'm
you
like,
shaking your heads.
Brent, I gotta give you a kiss.
Well, I'll take it.
So
there it is, we just enacted Judaism.
So I'll double down on what Brent's saying. I think that, Rav Nachman once said, if you say things that don't stir controversy, it means that you're not actually adding anything new. So, but doesn't mean I'm right, or it's even useful. But I want to double down on what Brent said. I think the conversation about Jewish identity is a pathological, toxic conversation that is a complete projection of a very small group of leaders for whom Judaism is not working for them in any substantive way. And that every time we talk about Jewish identity, we strip mine, no different than strip mining any mine. It really is a toxic conversation. Not only is it a toxic conversation internally, but it so misunderstands the most contemporary thoughts, understandings of identity, identity formation, fluid identities, hybrid identities. It's remarkable. If you had to construct a conversation that was the most toxic possible and helpful conversation you could create for a religious community in the early parts of the 21st century, given the seismic shifts in how being human is expressing itself now, you couldn't have come up with a better topic than Jewish identity.
And how do you feel?
We are, and I want to say one more thing, and that is that there is no Jewish identity problem. 94% of American Jews score out proud to be Jewish. 84% of American Jews say being Jewish is important to them. 75% of Jews say they have a strong sense of belonging. On top of that, according to Robert Putnam in American Grace, Jews are the most respected and admired, quotation marks, ethnic or religious group in the United States of America. There is no Jewish identity problem, but we have, as we have in many domains in America because of the seismic shifts, we have a breakdown, we have an institutional problem, and we have a leadership challenge. The leadership is completely, basically, American political leadership and the elite leadership is disconnected from Americans, and therefore we have a sick and toxic populism, and in American Jewish life, what we have is a complete disconnection between the elites. That is the rabbinic elites and the political elites from actual, normal, regular human beings. There's not a Jew that gets up in the morning and says, oh my God, I'm assimilated, right? A Jew gets up in the morning and says, oh my God, I'm intermarried. A Jew that gets up in the morning says, oh my God, I'm not kosher enough. So we actually have an entrepreneurial, they are entrepreneurial in that respect, they're interesting, identity industrial complex. And it has consultants, and it had demographers, and it has social scientists, and it has rabbis, and it has think tanks that actually make a living no different than the national security industry, no different than any domain. And it is misdiagnosing in a really significant way what it means to live in a moment of fundamental transformation, how we're understanding what it means to be human.
So I want to get back to it, but first I want Eleanor to have her shot at this.
Yeah, I want to go from the institutional back down to the personal, because as you say, as I listen to the two of you, I think 20 years ago, 25 years ago when I met my husband Peter, I'm not Jewish, Peter is, it was all, the whole discussion was about the Jewish identity of the children and what's going to happen to the Jewish
right.
identity of the children.
That's the anxiety.
It was a huge anxiety. I also understood exactly where the anxiety came from. My husband's mother survived the Holocaust in France and really felt that she survived to continue Judaism. God saved her to continue
right.
Judaism. So while it was a difficult set of years there, I did understand where she was coming from. And I'm not sure whether I want to agree or disagree with the whole topic, but I do know that that discussion sent me to a Derek Torah class here. I took an amazing class here for a year with my husband. We were ordered by Rabbi Rolli to both go. He said he couldn't drop out. He had to go with me to this Intro to Judaism class, which started me on a whole Jewish learning journey. And ultimately, I decided I'm not converting. I cannot convert, but my kids can be Jewish. And that seemed, I don't know if it staved off all the fears, but it sort of lowered some of the anxiety. Because I said we would have Orthodox rabbis. I thought there would be Orthodox rabbis tripping over themselves to convert my children when they were born. They weren't. But over the years, now it's 20 years later, and I have a 14-year-old, a 9-year-old, and an 11-year-old. And that anxiety that I integrated, assimilated, led me, and I'm a Christian minister. I went to Union Theological Seminary. I grew up Episcopalian, and I'm a UCC minister. That anxiety really, I shielded my kids from some things now that I regret. I think I kept them. I was so like, I'm going to show you I can do this Jewish identity thing with my kid. I don't really know what it is. I would love for someone to tell me, but damn it, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do my best to make this happen. And if that means that we don't do this and we don't do that, I'm going to show the world that I can do it. I'm going to prove everybody wrong. And I wish I hadn't had that anxiety sort of hanging over. And I see how, you know, my kids are curious anyway. Thank God, kids are curious. So they're going to find their own way. They're going to learn about my tradition, and it's clearly not too late. I'll stop there for now.
So let me follow up on something you said. First, I realized I didn't introduce myself, which is actually not much of a loss, but I'm Peter Rubenstein, director of the Bronfman Center and Jewish Community here at 92Y. And yes, I was a senior rabbi at Central Synagogue for 23 years, so I'm emeritus there. I want to actually use what you said, Eleanor, to kind of push back a little bit with Brent and Erwin. Because what you did is you said the issue of Jewish identity in your family was a discussion in terms of what it is. I often, by the way, agree that most Jews would find it difficult to say what that means and also would even find it difficult to say why should Jewish people survive. I mean, we take an assumption, you take the granted that we should be around, but it's really hard for people to say why, certainly for them individually. But the point is, Erwin and Brent, I think I'm hearing you say that the elite, the institutions, the leadership wrestle with this issue of Jewish identity as a problem. But let's take the problem part of it off the board. Let's take it to the personal level where it is really how do any of us as Jews operate? And some would say that I operate as a Jew with Jewish values out of a sense that I am a Jew, right? That my identity is a Jew. I'm aware of that. I do certain things because I'm a Jew. Now, am I hearing you say that's an improper way to frame it, or is it just that
yes.
we have had an institutions that have concretized that?
I'd say, yeah, it's a problem.
And how would you have people say it then?
Your hiking metaphor was perfect.
I'm less inclined to want to say how I would have people say it, because I think there's necessarily a diversity of how someone would say it. But among the things I would love people to say is, I'm fired up about Shabbat, and here's how my family celebrates Shabbat. I'm fired up about the idea that prayer in Hebrew is a reflexive verb, and when I pray, this is what I do to my do interior and exterior. I'm fired up about the idea of tzedakah as a form of justice, not as a form of charity, as a form of love. There are a million aspects of Jewish content that somebody could get fired up about. That's what I'd want someone to say.
But grounded in being a Jew, no?
No, grounded in the practice or wisdom, yeah. Not grounded in identity. It's like we have to stop using the word Judaism. It's like we have to stop using every single word and put different words in. It's not about whether the person is Jewish or not. That's what we're moving from. And that's going to be very, very complicated. We're moving towards a post-ethnic, post-peoplehood. That's where the planet is moving. And you can't have the Internet of Things. You can't have the globalization that we have. Yes, we have backlash, but most Jews are not part of the backlash, okay? And most millennials are not part of the backlash. And so it's not about the people. It's about human beings flourishing in their lives. And to the extent that the thing we call Jewish wisdom and practice, which itself is always morphing, to the extent that we see Jewish wisdom and practice actually working to help people flourish in a way that they could witness, and I'll use that term on purpose, in a way they could witness, this thing we call Jewish will continue. And to the extent that it can't, then it's been a great run. And our job is not to worry about the run, our job is to worry about our lives. And that's a really big difference.
I just want to point out, and then Sharon, yeah. I see you writhing to put something. I would point out that you talk about Jewish knowledge and wisdom and so on, and so and on that regard, I would agree. But we're back using the word Jewish. So,
Jewish knowledge is contested too. That's what's so complicated about the moment we live in. If you're living in the fourth century and someone breaks a glass under a chuppah, which a chuppah was already there, but breaking glass wasn't, the vast majority of the leadership in the room would say, oh my God, that's syncretistic. What are you using a Persian custom for? But people on the ground, it made meaning for them. It helped them flourish, however they understood it. And then the leadership transvalued that and said, okay, here's what it is. There's no such thing as pure Jewish. There's nothing pure. Everything is a mixture. Everything is an innovation. Even a tradition that makes it was an innovation at one time. So to worry about the essentialist quality of whatever it is that it is, the calling, the worrying about, the anxiety about, is it Jewish, is itself a projection of whoever's doing that, their own anxiety about their own Jewishness. And I understand it. I have less sympathy for the anxiety because I'm on the inside, but it's you have to heal from that anxiety. It's about whether any wisdom or any practice from any toolbox helps you flourish in your life, helps you develop webs of relationships that are loving and in which you're cared for when you're vulnerable. It's the metrics, is it working and helping you flourish? The metrics, is it Jewish? If it'll turn out Jewish or not Jewish, we'll see.
But can I play devil's advocate ask, I mean, I can't believe I'm asking this, but I'm going to.
I know.
Without the identity piece there, won't the toolbox just fall apart?
No, that's like saying if everyone's a carpenter, okay, everyone doesn't have to be a carpenter for there to be tools, okay? Tools are used when tools are used. It's just a tool. And we've made it, I understand why we've made it more than that, because essentially Jewish people, so much of the way in which we understood what it meant to be Jewish died somewhere in the early 1800s. And we haven't really, it's complicated. And so we latched on to things like peoplehood, and then luckily we had the Holocaust in Israel as twin anchors and to worry about how we held together. And now none of those things, neither religion, qua religion, neither the twin anchors of Holocaust Israel, or any sorts of ethnicity is going to be big enough, is going to be rich enough to hold together what we called or imagined, because it's just an imagination anyhow, the Jewish people. And that's the seismic shift. So now the only question is, tell me your practices, tell me what you do, tell me how it works for you, and if it works for you, I want some of it. That's, you know, that, and I know that's complicated, because you have to have, you have to try stuff. You have to live in a, and I don't mean to steal this, but I am stealing it. You have to imagine you're living in a playground, not a playpen.
All right, Erwin, let me give Sharon an opportunity.
One of the things that's very interesting to see is how a child develops a sense of religious identity, or even identity, period, right? I mean, I think identity in and of itself is complicated. Who are we? That's a really
right.
complicated search and question to answer. And so I watch my daughter, grapple with who am I? Am I Jewish? Am I Christian? My mother was raised Christian. We celebrate Christian traditions in our home as well as Jewish traditions. And when I first got married, that to my husband was a process of adaptation. Okay, we are going to do Christmas. And when we have a child, yes, I absolutely insist that we also have this tradition because that's how I grew up. That's the context in which I identify with. In many ways right now, I am the outsider to this conversation because I didn't have religious training. So I'm even a step behind you, Eleanor. And I'm learning, you know, in toddler kinds of ways, what Jewish religion is about through friendships, through Shababa, through my daughter. And when my daughter was about 5 or 6, she had this moment of, what am I, and is it okay to be Jewish and Christian? So she went around literally surveying people that she met. Hi, I'm Jewish and Christian, what about you? I celebrate this and this, what about you? And you know, as much as you may wish to move away from that identity conversation, I'm not sure that children organically will move away from it. I mean, I think that they really try first to understand what is the box, and then perhaps push it against it.
In other words, to use some of the language, one begins in a playpen, and maybe you're suggesting that's not an unhelpful thing, but until you should let them out into the playground. In other words, it's not one or the other, but sometimes it's evolution. And I want to speak about evolution, both in terms of us, right, us, and in terms of your particular families. And we're obviously in a world in which intermarriage is becoming, if not norm, you know, always increasing. And families are searching for how do you mold and mesh a new identity and so on. Tell us, and from your, you know, perspectives, and there are two of you here who have been there, and there are some of us who, you know, work with couples in that regard. In what way has that changed the way that Jews see themselves? We talked about it a little bit, but And as you, if you could give underlying principles, in what way is this evolving culture of ours, our evolving society, the evolving Jewish people, giving a different kind of sense of what it means to be identified?
I think it's such a complicated question because really beyond Judaism, we're talking about a global
Correct.
World that's constantly shifting. And so the identity I had in Brazil got really blown up when I came here at 12, and suddenly there wasn't this enormous family around me all the time. And so even the question of family and identity and, you know, who are your people, so to speak, is really complicated. Because who are your people ends up being who are the people who are there for you, who have your back. and who you can really trust and turn to, not just in your moment of glory, which of course everybody's there, but in your moment when you're really down and out. And I think, you know, I believe that we come to better understanding of things when we're willing to come to the table and really talk about what it is, as opposed to saying, you know, I'm not anti-Semitic and just leaving it at that. I think actually the way we appreciate each other is through sharing language, through sharing culture, through sharing food. And so in my relationship with Judaism, I feel like I was ready to jump right in, you know, share it all. Let me sit here and really see what it's about. And there are parts of it that don't yet make sense to me, and there are parts of it that do. And I hear you sort of saying that that's the case
for everybody.
For you too.
Yes, that's the case for sure in my
right?
own biography.
Yeah, Brent?
So not too long ago, my wife was very ill, and thank God she's in great health now, totally in great shape. And but for the time that she was ill, my communities carried me and my kids through that. And one of those communities is absolutely my synagogue community, the people who are part of the synagogue, not all of whom are Jews, who took care of me, took care of my kids. My best friend in the small town where I live is the Presbyterian minister. And I remember very clearly, you know, thinking about hard times, calling him up one night, so afraid of what was unfolding in front of us, I literally just called and cried. I didn't even say anything. And he showed up at my house about 5 minutes later with a bottle of scotch and just sat there with me and cried and talked and drank and talked. And I couldn't trust him more. Like, on one level, we don't share certain religious vernaculars. He's a Presbyterian minister, I'm a conservative rabbi. In other ways, we share lots and lots of things in common. We're two 40-something-year-old fathers of kids in a small town with a similar commitment to all sorts of things. And so over the summer, when I was at the Hartman Institute in Jerusalem, there was lots of talk about Jewish identity and Jewish peoplehood. And, you know, being in Israel, of course, there's lots of conversations about the settlements and the West Bank. I don't have any framework that allows me to say that there's a notion of peoplehood, of community, that puts me in the same category as somebody doing something in the settlements that I find morally abhorrent, even if we put on the same tefillin in the morning
right.
or say the same brachot over our food,
right.
but puts me in a different category than my friend Ben, who doesn't say the same words, but shares my same values. If I needed to ask someone to take care of my kids in my absence, without a second thought, I would ask Ben over somebody in the settlement. So the question of what is a community, what is a nation, what is a people, the cultural markers, all of these things of, say, a shared language, though I want to come back to that, is important, but only goes so far. And I think that, you know, some of the toxicity that Erwin's talking about is saying these values matter, you know, Shani Medebebe Evrit, but these that I speak in Hebrew, but these other values of kindness, compassion, whatever it might be, don't matter. And that's all assuming that there actually is a shared language. But part of what's happened, I think, is that for my generation at least, and but not just my generation, the content of Jewish life has been so emaciated that the idea that there's a shared language, I think, is actually not true, right? Beyond saying, oh yeah, you hated Hebrew school, I hated Hebrew school too, right? It's a minority, I think, of liberal Jews who can access the richness of the tradition in ways that are meaningful, and those who can, it's very rarely a shared language.
So I'm going to use or introduce the word hybridization. I mean, in a certain way, it's what Jews, our history has always been that we take on elements of other cultures and other, and we're living in a, you know, a tremendously multi-faith, multi-language, multi-identity period of time. And what we know about species is hybrids actually have greater resilience than those organisms that aren't. Is that the way, is that a word that, or would that make sense in terms of the way you're trying to describe it? Is that, do you feel, I mean, do we feel that?
Yes, and I think it is deeply unsettling. And, you know, I heard a wonderful wise man the other day say, Sharon, the day you feel settled, you'll be in a box. You know, this is what being human is about, you know, feeling unsettled. And sometimes when we try to frame things in sort of the settled kind of way, which I think maybe this is what you're speaking to a little bit, that there's more fluidity there, right, than rigidity, and that when we try to trap things into a rigid state, this is not productive or helpful. I apologize, I don't use the same words, but you know, I think this piece of identity, it really is beyond just Judaism. It's a struggle, right? That it is a human struggle. And I have had situations where I was left out, actually, of coming to the table in a particular relationship with a Jewish friend. And it felt very confusing because this person actually was studying to be a rabbi. And I thought, what is this, right? Why am I not invited to this particular ritual? Oh, well, you're not Jewish, you know? And I think that that hopefully, right, isn't something that we move forward with as an idea of what we need to do with our identities or religion.
When my daughter was 8 or 9, someone at her school said, she goes to a Jewish day school, she said, is your mom Jewish? And then she said, no. Well, you know, that means you're not Jewish. And my daughter turned to her and apparently paused, the teacher said, and said, it's complicated, and walked off. And when I heard this, my first reaction was, it's not complicated. There are a bunch of ways you can be Jewish. Your mom can be Jewish, your dad can be Jewish in some movements, and you can be converted. That's the answer. And that's clearly my own anxiety about this whole Jewish identity thing, and is it gonna stick, and wanting my daughter to stand up for herself. And the fact is, she's right, it's complicated. And there's always, on a personal level, there's always this balance of the worlds in which we live and move and have our being, and how those worlds accept us and don't accept us. And couples come to me and we talk about, I can't do this, or should we make this decision? And I feel like a big question is, in what community do you want to exist? Exactly. If you want to be in Crown Heights, then this is probably not going to work. What I'm so grateful for is that I have found communities on the Upper West Side, B'nai Jeshurun and now Romamu, that where I felt I could be myself, where my children could be themselves, and where now, and the people with whom I work, the couples are pushing me because some are coming and raising their kids Jewish and Christian, very seriously Jewish and Christian. They're doing church and they're doing synagogue on a weekend. I don't know how they fit it all in, but they are, and they're doing it. And I'm still, I mean, I have to admit that I'm still like, how does that work? Because I made a different choice in my family. But I have to say that being in a community that is, we haven't used the word hybridization, but in a community that is okay with this ambiguity, where the term conversion is not really being used as much anymore. As they're playing with other things, trying to find other ways to say to people, you want to naturalize, maybe you can have dual citizenship, using that kind of language. But being in that kind of community where there's freedom and there is an invitation, and that whatever you bring through the door is radically welcome, and it's not despite the diversity, but it's you're welcome because of it. We need you here because all the religions are organs in the body. We need each of those organs. It's the Red Zalman quote.
I understand my mic isn't working. I'm not sure this works. We're here with 100 or more people who are involved in the experiences with children, whether we call it education or other, especially through the technique that has belovedly been called Shababa. What would you want us to be doing with our children? What would you want these 100 people to take home with them, to think about in terms of the way that they talk to try to have experiences with our children, your children? What is it that, if they could keep something in their mind, what would it be?
Fun Judaism. I mean, what you mentioned it, there was a lot of boring, and not just Judaism, but boring everything out there over the last 40 years.
In religion in general.
And And make it, I mean, if it's not going to help you flourish, really, it's not worth it. And so I feel like it seems like you are. Playground, right. I mean, have fun with it and make it meaningful and relevant and find ways to take what is particular about Judaism and about Jewish traditions and recognize the beautiful universality in them and apply it and translate it to the people with whom you work. And
that's right.
I can speak for Shababa, having experienced it, that I very much feel that that's what it's been. And I think having our leader, Karina Zilberman, be a person who also comes from a different culture, who brought in the energy of fun, the energy of life, the music, the connection with the individual kids, with the individual parents, and really encouraging that connection with parent to parent, children to children, by getting to know each of us. I think that that's really, it's invaluable, and it goes back to my point about having people talk through sometimes what's different, right? And if it's actually really different, or, you know, do we all have this need to have a shoulder when we're struggling with X, Y, and Z about our child? And that's truly, I know, in the 7 years that I've been part of Shababa, that, you know, that has been part, really, of that extended family that doesn't exist for families today.
Yeah, I mean, in a certain way, relationship and family are words that come to the fore when you talk about it. Brent, you wanted to...
Yeah, I wanted to entirely acknowledge and endorse the idea of having fun. That's great and important, particularly with kids. But also build on that a little bit to the idea of family and commitment to that, right? Not commitment to the abstract notion of Judaism, right, but commitment to the actual people in your actual community. In my small community, I think some of the greatest moments are when we've really facilitated some real intergenerational connections, which we've done to some degree, not as much as I hope to. But the sense of, oh, these people, these are real people. And these are people who my family is going to connect with and build real relationships with, emerging from a place of fun, not from the heavy, oh God, I guess I have to do this. But in the sense of a relationship, I do these fun things with these people, but it's not just I'm showing up at the gym and doing this fun thing and leaving, but I'm coming to this community, this gathering, doing this fun thing and building these relationships that matter and that I'm committed to. So a commitment to the practice, whatever the practice might be, and a commitment to the community, the larger family that emerges from that practice.
Yeah, I'll double down on that too. If I was advising,
we're going to play poker after.
Yeah, I know, and we do work with, you know, schools and leadership. This is hard to do. Try not to teach, do, say anything that you associate with being Jewish, with the goal of making people more Jewish. And that's going to be very hard. That'll take you at least a few years. Then the next thing is to try to, every time you use something you experience as Jewish, a piece of wisdom, a practice, a sensibility, a word, it doesn't matter what it is. If you think it's Jewish and you're using it as a Jewish thing, try to make sure that it helps someone in a real way. And real way means we're using the word flourishing, we use the word fun, we use sense of family responsibility. People have different problems, not problems being bad. People have different challenges at different points in their life. And my daughter got married last Sunday, and the challenges, listen, the challenges of parenting a daughter who's in the wedding stage is really different than parenting a five-year-old daughter. And being 59, having your daughter married is really different than being 31 when she's just born and you're in your most ambitious stage of your life. So Jewish is a very, very, very large treasure box, toolbox, or irrelevant box that we're going to learn in the next 25 to 75 years, it looks like, for all these religions, all the Western religions for sure, in a place like America. We're going to learn whether any of the tools, any of the technologies actually work in any significant way to help people flourish. And there is a real fight on the planet about that right now. And we need tools to fight in a healthy way too. But it's the same, just like America's having a real challenge about what it means to have a boundary and a border. How do we guard those borders, or are they maximally porous? That's the same question every group is having in the world. We have a taxing problem. What is our obligations to each other as Americans? And that's in the tax. Well, it's the same thing. What are our obligations to each other in this thing called Jewish? Who is on the inside? Who is on the outside? So it's the same problems that we're having in this thing called Jewish that every single group in the West is having. And the last thing is then the most important thing, once you don't do anything out of an anxiety about identity, and you do everything out of, do I think this is gonna help someone flourish in a real descriptive, embodied, pragmatic, individual, familial way, the next thing to do is to know who you are in the drama. Because there are a lot of dramas going on, and that's, I think, what you mean in a really wise way about what community do you wanna put your stake in? Because if you want to put your stake in the Crown Heights community, then you have a different set of anxieties and a different set of expectations and goals. And if you want to put yourself in a engaged, globalized community, that's different. So you have to know who you are in the drama and where you want to embed yourself.
No, I just want to pick up again on some words that have been used, because I think they're so helpful. If we could just have go back, we'll look at the tape and put this vocabulary together. But the issue of what matters and the clarity to us as to what really does matter for us, whether it's family or relationship, I mean, so many things that you talked about become essentially important for us to get some clarity about that. And I think that's true, especially of educators, people who are working with our children, to have some clarity about that for them and to help their children and their children's families to figure out what that means for them. Now, one of the things that matter to us right now, the questions that I hope our assembled listeners who have been so quiet and forbearing, the questions that you have for us. So I obviously cannot see you, but if I can see some in the front row, I will start with the ones I can see in the front row, and then I'm just going to assume that there are those of you going back who would just yell out the question. Let's start over here, 1, 2.
Excuse me?
Yes, it will stand, and I'll try and repeat the question.
Okay, great. It's been so incredibly refreshing as a millennial to hear this talk about fluidity and in relation to identity. And I'm so curious to hear from you where perhaps neshama, where soul comes into that conversation. And what your thoughts are on that.
All right, I'm going to repeat that, and then we're going to get a couple of questions, and then we'll have the opportunity. So the question was, where does neshama, soul, come into the equation in this whole discussion? And here?
Thank you. As the director of education in a congregational Hebrew school, whose goal is to try to make Judaism engaging and wonderful, and it's working with the kids, but the bottom line is, great idea. If it doesn't flourish and it doesn't enrich people's lives, so then it won't stick. But if people don't know, and these parents don't know, and the kids are up on the bima having a great time, and the parents are sitting there like deer in headlights, and they don't generally come to learn, even though we try in little bits get them, but how can we possibly keep it alive and get it to give, let them flourish when they don't know all the beauty that Judaism
In other words, so let me try and repeat it. And then, Karine, I see you out there. Maybe you're going to help me. You're going to help me field some of the questions in terms of just pointing out because I can't see. I think the question is, how do you know what you don't know, right?
Yeah.
How do the parents know?
If we want Judaism to help them flourish, how do we get them to know when they don't know what they don't know?
So this has to do with the parents. You know, in other words, what's our responsibility with the parents of these children? Let's take one more question. Karine, if you could just choose somebody.
Would you like to?
Sure.
Yes. Okay, so you were saying you, Brett, and Erwin were against Jewish identity as an identity. Then where's the role of conversion?
All right, so three questions. Neshama, right? Conversion, and how do we create an experience for parents where they learn what they should be dealing with their children, what they can share with their parents? All right.
So these two questions,
you want to take all three of it?
No, No, right. I'm going to take the first
any
two.
Any one or two.
I don't know, maybe number three will get I'll in there. But the I'm actually thinking that these two for me are linked.
All right, we have an answer to the parent question, so in addition to whatever you're going to answer.
Okay. I know when I go to synagogue, we joke in our family that I'm a questioning Christian and a practicing Jew. Because I wouldn't go to synagogue if my soul were not moved. And I've been to a lot of synagogues where my soul was not moved. Been to a lot of churches where it wasn't moved either. But I feel like I might be projecting my own sort of orientation, which is I like that moment. I mean, once you walk in and this starts, you've got me. So I don't know what the orientation is and what your, I don't know how you, maybe getting them into synagogue is pretty difficult. But if there is something that is spiritually moving that allows people to access their neshama, their soul, their emotion, that allows a sort of cathartic moment, maybe it's crying, maybe it's anger, like whatever, I mean, it's like a soul spa sometimes, I feel. If that happens, people are gonna come.
Sharon?
I would agree. And that was the direction I was headed in answering that question. I think people have to have motivation to come, and they're going to have motivation to come if you figure out what the questions they have are. And sometimes even in questioning how to parent, not even in the framework of let me teach you what's beautiful about Judaism, because that to me almost feels forced, like you must know this.
Right.
But rather, what is it that they need? And really listening to the community as to what that is. Maybe parents there who are struggling to raise a child who has special needs, or maybe a parent there who's struggling to raise whatever it is. It's always a struggle to raise, right? We're always sort of.
I think sometimes the question is not what do they need, but what do they want. I mean, I think sometimes we impose upon them what we think they need, rather than necessarily what they're in the search for. Brent, you.
I'll start with Julia's question about conversion. Julia is a friend and a member of my community and somebody I was honored to help on her path to conversion, which was an incredibly powerful experience, certainly for me, and I think for you as well. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't be sitting here today. I actually think all three of these questions are related. I think the question of soul is necessarily the first question, right? What do we do that nourishes people's soul? And I think that oftentimes we rabbis, Jewish leader, educator types, are mistakenly think we're in the business of ethnic preservation. We're not. We're in the business of spiritual inspiration. And we have to start there and we have to end there. And if we're not somewhat obsessed with the question of how are we feeding people's soul, I don't think we're doing anybody any favors. That said, I think the commitment question and the willingness of people to engage in this is a tough one. I try to remind myself frequently that, you know, you, Irwin, quoted Rabbi Nachman before. In his lifetime, Rabbi Nachman had like 10, maybe 20 Hasidim. Now we think, oh, Rabbi Nachman. And that's great. But I'm aware that I would like to think that everybody is looking for that soul piece. And in my community, the people who are looking for that soul piece are the people who I connect with most fully. But even in my community, it's a minority of people. I want to think everybody is looking for that soul piece, and you should come up and hang out in Beacon anytime you want. Yeah. But the truth is, not everyone is, and not everyone is necessarily willing to prioritize that. You know, one of the things we do in our community, and this is a constant source of frustration for me, I do Shabbat morning services in the forest. So we go out, we go hiking in the forest, we do chanting and things in the forest. People hear about it, they say, oh my God, that's incredible. People in my community hear, that's amazing, I love that you're doing that. When it actually comes time to do it, then there are all of these other things. And so in the same way, I mean, I'm very aware of tripping into a trap I've tried to avoid, where in your standard conservative synagogue, Jewish practice is subcontracted out to the rabbi. We, the congregants, aren't gonna keep kosher, keep Shabbat, but we want you, the rabbi, to do it. I've just got the slightly hippie version of that. We, the congregants, are gonna go meditate in the forest, but we want you to do that. But it's very hard, and it's a constant struggle to get people to do the spiritual work? And I don't have an easy answer for it, but I acknowledge it's a really real problem. I think not everybody is really looking to do that work. I think not everybody is willing or comfortable to dive into the discomfort and the unsettling that's necessary to do real soul work. It's a lot easier to, you know, eat a bagel than to do a cheshbon and neveh, do an accounting of your soul and figure out where you want to go. That said, and this gets to your question, Julia, I think that the question of conversion is actually very important. And I'm curious to hear that Romamu is sort of putting some distance from that question, because I think the idea of saying, I want to make a commitment to certain practices and certain communities, not to an identity, but to saying, okay, I'm going to engage with Shabbat. And anybody, well, I know for me, and I suspect this is true for anybody who's engaged seriously with any spiritual practice, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't, right? And the question, you know, I have written over my desk the line from the Gemara, Hamotzi mechavro alav haraya, the one who wants something from their fellow, the proof's on them. So if I want you to come to Shabbat services, either in the synagogue or in the forest, it's on me to make the case why. But if somebody really wants to grow in that, they have to make a commitment to the practice or the practices and to the community of that practice. Just simply, you know, dipping your toe in now and then, while legitimate, won't really nourish people. And the people who, I mean, I'll say, like you, who have made that commitment to a practice and to a community, I think conversion is an appropriate way of lifting up that commitment, celebrating that commitment, concretizing that commitment. But it's the commitment, the celebration follows the commitment, not precedes it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Karina, I'm going to ask you to bring on three more questions.
You ain't seen nothing yet.
Big problem that we don't know what to do about. I'd love to have you solve the problem, but I'm also just interested from your perspective, like, how do you think about and address that question?
So can I assume everybody heard that question, or do in the back, should I repeat it for people in the back? I don't know. The question really is...
can you create a minion with non-Jews?
Yeah, you know, it has to do with specifically with saying of Kaddish, and the question is, you know, you're in the bind between halakha and a new world and a new reality. How do you solve it?
There's no abstract answer to the question, because the question has nothing to do... The question is a transference from the anxieties of the 10 people in the room. And the only important thing about that question is the process by which the people who think they're in some sort of relationships, 10 people, 8 people, 6 people, 12 people, it's about their relationships. So how you go through answering that question with that group of people will determine something far more important than whether you say Kaddish or not. The question is just like it becomes a tool. It's just grist for the wisdom and lightning mill of the group itself. And whoever's facilitating that group, whoever is psychologically most evolved in that group, has to be aware of the anxieties and fears and hopes and fantasies and nightmares that go behind that question. And that's the job. Because at the end of the process of yes, no, which will probably in a community like yours have to be somewhat playful, okay, and there's a lot of internal Jewish concepts regarding that. that I can share with you another time, but it's fun. All we're going to have in the next round are boundary questions. That's why the playground is so important. We're only going to have living laboratory questions. And the question is, how comfortable are you in asking the question with the anxiety the question will produce for the people most anxious in the group? And if it turns out the answer is no, for those other people who want the answer to be yes. And that's the job of leadership. That's the job of helping to manage the very, very, very complex psychological changes and literally evolutionary, I'll use the word, the evolutionary quantum jumps we're asking ourselves and other people to make. It's not about the question. Because if you live in the question's answer from a halachic, whatever we mean by that, in a post-halachic world, is obviously not, okay? The answer in the creative next iterations of living in, like, if you were living in 130 CE, and there wasn't even a seder, there was no sitter, there was no kaddish, there was no notion of minyan, there was no bracha yet that we even knew which brachas went with what. You're living in 130 now, you're not living in 1620. And even 1620 is a projection. But so the question is, does the group want to be in the playground? And that's psychologically a very, very, very challenging question.
I think sometimes, I think sometimes you also forget to question why we do what we do. So I also wonder if that's part of the disengagement, that there are so many people who think, well, this is what I do. I grew up going to the synagogue, so that's what I'm doing.
Over.
I'm, you know, sending my kids there. But they're actually not really thinking about the why.
Well, that's part, the job
part,
to get done.
Part
I
of it is
really important. Everybody should read a new book called Competing with Luck. Just read the first chapter by Clay Christensen. It's really, really important, and this gets to your point, is that these things have jobs to get done, but they're complex jobs. For many people, when they say they want to say Kaddish, it's actually not to remember the person. It's to create some either healthy or fetishized version of connection to an imagined people. And so that is both very, 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 very important to know, but long-term, not important for the person, because it's too vicarious, and it's an abstract. That's not what Kaddish is. So, or I put it this way, what job Kaddish is getting done is up for debate too. And when you clarify the jobs, then you'll know the halacha around how to say Kaddish. Right now, we have a lot of accretion of halacha around things that we do that are completely disconnected from any real job in people's lives, except some fetishized, exoticized job.
I would just say, Jewish history proves several things. One is that tradition wasn't always, and neither was ritual. And that the things that we think of as traditional now were at one point actually revolutionary acts against what was then considered traditional. So we're the real beauty of Judaism is that it's always evolved and always innovated, and that's we're in that.
It's the beauty of anything that lives.
Well, we're alive. So let's get two more questions.
Can't escape where you are.
And so I'm wondering about the place of putting ourselves in uncomfortable situations. Like, what I've realized about Israel is that it so needs, I think, what you were talking about, Erwin and Brent and all of you, that kind of openness, that kind of, you know, how does the tool of our identity make us into more full human beings? And then I wonder about the opposite thing here, that how can we still have a robust Jewish identity here, or kind of a robust life something that they might not know that they need? And what about putting them in a difficult place of wrestling with that text that they didn't even know, and they're on their iPhones, but open up a Gemara, what does that look like? So I'm just wondering about that place of discomfort, the place of Israel, and this discussion.
Big questions. Let's take one more. Karina? Thank you.
There's so many authentic voices, and I would like to just add that to the conversation.
Yeah, so not so much a question, but in a way, it's an editorial that our perspective is formed by our experience, and not all of us have the same experience, and therefore not all of us have the same perspective.
I feel like in some ways these were actually, these three questions, comments, all sort of grouped together. Dasi, your question about Israel, about national identity, about Kaddish, have to do with a group identity, with a national identity. And for me at least, I'm not actually arguing against the idea of a collective identity. I'm arguing against the national identity that I've inherited.
Right.
There's arguably the most important book in the social sciences, a book called Imagine Communities by Benedict Anderson. And he basically explores the question, what is it, and this book's probably like the early 80s. He explores the question, what is it that allows a group of people to consider themselves part of the same nation, right? And he says, the book basically opens by saying, even members of the smallest nation will never meet any more than a fraction of that nation, right? Let's take the Jews, for instance. A relatively small nation. I know a lot of Jews. I don't know if I know 1% of the Jews in the world, right? So the question of what are the mental frameworks that allow me to feel connected, part of collective enterprise with someone else? And you know that gets to the question of Kaddish and gets to the question of Israel as well in certain ways. And what? So I grew up here in New York. I grew up totally, you know, secular, Brooklyn, bagels and locks sort of thing. And it wasn't until I went to high school and then to Israel that I started getting into Judaism. And my concern, my big driving concern, is that as American Judaism has stripped away theology, stripped away practice, stripped away anything in the treasure box, what we're left with is a blood identity, and that what we make the collective identity is just the collective identity, because we can't say, oh, the other Jews, those are the people who celebrate Shabbat, or who daven, or who put on tefillin, or observe kashrut, or do any one thing, right? Or do even a constellation of things. So the question I want to ask about collective identity is not, are you Jewish, but what do we share in common? And I think that if there is a shared purpose, a shared mission, a shared practice, a shared understanding, there is room for a sense of an identity larger than just myself. But in the absence of that, we're left with reifying ourselves.
Right.
I think the hardest example of this, and this is, so I was a journalist before I was a newspaper reporter, and so I'm sure many of us know the story of Daniel Pearl, a reporter for the Wall Street Journal, who was killed for being a Jew. And we, the American Jewish community, and he was a heroic man, he was a brave man, and he was tortured and killed for no justifiable reason whatsoever, to state the obvious. His dying words were, "I am a Jew." And those were incredibly brave words in his context. But it is notable, and I'll say alarming, to note that arguably the most famous Jewish martyr of our lifetime, of my lifetime, died with his identity on his lips. And I contrast that with arguably the most famous Jewish martyr period, Rabbi Akiva, who died with the word Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad on his lips. Rabbi Akiva died as a martyr to God. We have created a martyrdom of Jewish identity in the story of Daniel Pearl. And I recognize these words sound harsh. They sound even harsh to me as I say them. But I would challenge all of us to say, what is the content that we would ask somebody to be so committed to that they would even to the degree of martyrdom, God forbid that any of us be there. But the question isn't, is there a collective identity about Judaism as this abstract label? For me, the question is there a collective identity around a practice, a belief, a language, an understanding that we share beyond the label? And that's the question that I think undergirds the question of Israel. Because, Dasi, I'm excited to go to Israel and see Leon on Monday, right? And when I go to Israel and I'm sitting at Hartman and then I go daven at Zion and then I hang out with my friends at Pardes, I say, yes, these are my people. But when I go to Tel Aviv and I, you know, hang out with people, I mean, I don't hang out with, I see people driving Lamborghinis with no necessary connection to Judaism, or people in the Shtachim having a connection to Judaism that I find abhorrent, I ask, what is it that I actually have in common with those people?
Right, that's why right now, I think that's right on. The questions are all very, very similar. They're all about these new boundary questions. That's why the most important question we can ask ourselves right now is, who am I in the drama? Of course that there's going to be communities that have backlash. There are communities that come from more orphaned histories that produce certain sorts of reactions. There's no such, we can't just generally make an abstract about any imagined community. So one is, who am I in the drama? Am I self-aware enough that this is why I've positioned myself or I've wound up being positioned here? And then the drama is always embedded in some sort of group. No one lives alone. So that you're always in some group and always to be, again, if you're the leader, teacher, educator, more enlightened person, more self-aware person, who am I, or where am I, in what communities or in what spaces, places am I embedded with my particular drama? And those are very, very, very important. And then the third is, and how do I make sure I'm talking to people outside of my particular drama in my particular community, which generally shares my drama? And in that respect, we are in a very, very serious fault line.
All right, Erwin, we're coming to the end of our time, and I'm always aware of the timing, so I just would have one last question with a hopefully short answer. I think I know, Erwin, your answer because you just talked it. If you had to rename the session.
Well, I named the session.
You just did.
Oh, that was, named that I session? Named the session, yes.
All right, so it's not, where am I in the drama?
No, this is about identity. Well, they asked me to give a title about identity, so I said, you know, truth, fears. I actually did delusions, but then I said, don't do that.
We actually, I think, addressed fears and illusions and hopes and maybe even truths, but would you give it a different name?
Oh, my goodness. The search for identity?
The search for identity. Eleanor?
Think about, I don't know, something about spiritual journeys.
Spiritual journeys. Mm. Brent?
I'd go to that session.
You'd go to that session.
You know, something on nourishing your soul, what works from the Jewish toolbox.
Nourishing your soul, what works from the Jewish toolbox. Listen, this has been, as one who's tried to moderate it, but would love to, so many times jumped in. I just wanted to express on behalf of this congregation and this audience, and I add my own incredible appreciation, Sharon and Irwin and Eleanor and Brent, for your wisdom, your thoughtfulness, and your willingness to share the honesty of your belief in your hearts with us. So thank you very much.
Thank you.